let me set the scene, because yes. Folks, this is a very Brushwood Christmas. For all the Brushwoods to come together to witness the first flight of a piece of equipment that will take Brian's career to the next level.
Yes, very, very excited about it. Every holiday, at Christmas, somebody gets a different quadcopter. This is not like the other quadcopters. Those other quadcopters, they were dumb. They just did what they just followed orders. They did what they were told. This one's got a GPS, knows where it is, knows where it's supposed to be, and it's able to make some decisions. So the moment I grab this thing, it feels the downward force, and it thinks, I'm about to crash.
I'm a very expensive piece of equipment, so we should not crash because I'm very expensive.
So the blades just fire into overdrive. I look as I'm holding a fucking Cuisinart chopping away at the moneymakers. Just my fucking hand is out of there. This thing's on the ground. And Bonnie, for some reason, runs over.
It was still coming from my dad and me.
And kicks it. Oh, he's outdone himself this time, ladies and gentlemen. It is Tuesday night, and we just set the stage for Night Attack, bringing you the best of the internet ever since 1776. Hello, beautiful folks. I'm Brian Brushwood, live in Austin, Texas. Opening animations brought to you by none other than Spearmint Nitrate, live in Oakland, California. Aus Oakland. Old Aussie Oakland.
Yeah.
It's the other Oakland. Down south, you might say. It's a G'day, Justin Robert Young.
Hey, man, what's going on?
Why ain't you doing the accent?
We're all just here to say it. We're all here in Oakland.
The other Oakland, as we love to be called.
Will, back in old 1904 when the two Oaklands, they did split. Here we are,
Okay, it wouldn't be accurate, but what if Justin Long played middle-aged Marty McFly? Because that's about how he looked.
Middle-aged Marty McFly.
Yeah. Like they'd have to age him up a little for where he is right now, but I think he could pull it off. No?
Yeah. Sounds legit.
All right. Yeah, that's a reference to pre-show bits, which you would know about if you were a Patreon. How you doing,
hey,
bud?
Listen, we had a fire pre-show, man. It was on all cylinders. This show's got to be garbage, but guess what? We got amazing stories. We have all the usual people here, of course, our producer, Bryce Neshcom Castillo.
Hi.
And the invisible wife, Bonnie Brushwood, joining us.
Hello.
Hey, man, how was your week? This is you and I, we had an intense vacation, and then we're like, peace outie. And then we saw each other. We're like, oh, that's right. We're married forever. And then it's like, I'll see you in a few days.
And we will, actually, because we're going to be in the same place in like another seven
that's
days.
Right.
So.
That's right.
Really?
Yes. Yes. We're setting up a dormitory at the Brushwood household.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is kind of feeling like South by Southwest of old when you guys were a real flop house. There's a few people. I'm going to be there. And of course, Mystery White.
He's not American. He's the other white meat.
Yeah.
From the other side.
Yeah. Hello from the other side.
And he loves to sing about the other side. No. All right. So what's your week look like? You got back in the groove? You're running every day?
Sure, yeah. No, you know, it's we're getting back into the groove here. We actually have a couple of Ashley's friends came into town, and it's kind of made us realize we don't have enough space for people to come into town anymore. Like until we get a larger space. Like Brian, you've been in the apartment. It's not exactly spacious.
No, and the inflated bed doesn't exactly stay inflated, and it's not exactly convenient to be literally laying in the hallway that connects the bedroom to the kitchen.
We got a railroad. That's the problem here, Brian. We got a railroad, and meanwhile, our house guests are the damsel in distress tied to the tracks because we have to go right over them every single morning. And it's fine. They're great. Well, I love having them here, and it's It's definitely a fun time, but it's really kind of drawn a hard line in the sand for future gets here.
Here's the moment is when you realize, like, I would rather. Yeah, that's when you start looking at local hotels and realize, like, for $89.99. we cannot have somebody laying there. And you're like, that sounds real good. And it's like, you just want to be that guy that's just like, yeah, no, we'll take care of you. Come on over. Don't worry about a thing. And it's like, your room is down the hall, downstairs, across the street, three blocks down, get an Uber, and it's great. It's a great room.
I'll tell you what, we've hired people to take care of you. It's gonna be an amazing time. Meanwhile, Brian, you've had a hell of a week. You went on family vacation, right?
Yeah, I guess last time we talked, the most interesting thing that happened was I injured my hand again, which means it was great that this was Spearmint Nitrates Open when I chopped up my hands. But I did mention that I went to the ER and they were like, yeah, you probably should have gotten stitches on that, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I didn't, and it was too late. And instead, I just held my index finger straight for a week. And look at this shit. Ready?
Okay. So just to give everybody a sense of what happened, you wound up screwing up your hand.
Well, and, yes. No. I slammed down with a hammer. Yeah.
You were going to go and get stitches. You figured you could tough it out for a night. The next day, you realize, wow, I really should have gotten stitches last night, but going to the emergency room that next day, they're like, well, I mean, man, we can tear it back open and then stitch it, or you can just be Brian the Pointer for the rest of the week.
And that's exactly what I did, right? I put pressure on it, I put a Band-Aid around it, I wrapped it, and I just held a finger straight for a week straight. And I gotta tell you, man, it's great. Like, normally, you know, when you get stitches, there's like the, I don't know, it just stretches things weird and you get the kind of lumpiness on there. Like, half of it has healed so smooth that you can't even see the place where the original injury happened. And the other, like, look at that.
It's as smooth as a cat's. It looks pretty smooth.
Don't that look good?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, geez. I mean, you want to eat dinner off it.
Yeah. And so anyway.
I did.
But the only problem is you go a freaking week with your fingers straight. And so this weekend we took a vacation and we went to the same place you and I went. We went and visited the manatees at Crystal River in Florida. And it's a bunch of weird things, like just a bunch of stars aligned. And so we flew out there and it turns out the cheapest car, you got the standard, you got the economy, even cheaper, and you got cheaper than the economy because I booked last minute, because I booked 72 hours before the weekend. The cheapest vehicle was the 15-passenger mini or full van, the 15-passenger van. It was like $20 a day, and so we took that.
you're in the mystery machine, man. You, the girls, Bonnie, you're the whole Brushwood family piling into this gigantic cargo van.
This thing could eat the mystery machine and still have room for another Kia Soul. I mean, it was insane.
Damn. you're in Snoop's tour bus.
Well, yeah, and so we go, and it was delightful, and it was super, super busy, right? Nonstop. We only got the one room for us, so there's five of us in one room. Five of us. An adult and a kid in the double bed, and then Penny on the floor, which means, I don't know if you know this, girls like to get up and go pee-pee in the nighttime, sleeping was difficult. It was very, very busy. I didn't bathe until the third night, because
he likes to stink. But
well, no, I mean, also you go swimming; it's the same thing. You smell like chlorine.
So wait a minute. Because initially this was a hardship. You're like, hey, listen, a lot of girls in and out of the bathroom, no privacy for old BB here. But meanwhile, it's like I didn't shower for 7 days. It's like, yeah, because you don't like showering.
No, like, I do like showering.
I mean, all you gotta do is just get under the hose a little bit. You know, just got a few paper towels. Oh, all of a sudden you're good to go, right as rain.
Like, you really could have gotten in there and showered. I don't know about you, but I showered every day.
I didn't shower until, as BJ Shively puts it in the chat, I was covered in mana pee. Yes. That was the first time. But also the girls used all the towels, and you're just like, nobody's complaining, and so you just deal with it. And then yesterday, holy crap, this was yesterday. Whoa, Bonnie, yesterday morning, we woke up at 2:55 Central Time, 3:55 East Coast Time.
Mm-hmm.
We drove.
That's right, we did.
2 hours.
Yes.
To the airport. Uh-huh. It was like you know what it's like to do a Go Game gig, right? Like, it's like you have only one person to blame. You're like, well, past me made this bargain with the devil, and here we are, and I'm going to deal with it because past me did it. Man, it's different when you're pulling three kids, a wife, and two grandparents in tow in your 15-passenger van. And you're making them all pay because you're like, well, that's the cheapest nonstop, and I guess that's what we're doing.
Bleep, oh, my God. So that's a full-scale operation. Like, you know, you've got to be up 7 hours before you need everybody out the door to make sure that crew is getting in the van, right?
Yeah.
A little bit.
It was a wee bit challenging. And but we made it home, and then it's like, aha, here we go. And it was a highly stressful, I guess, from 2:55 till 11 a.m. was nothing but driving and traveling with kids and everything. And we made it home, and I have to prepare for weird things, cord killers, and spoiler in time.
You still like didn't have enough time to get all the way ready for that.
Yeah, correct. And so, but we make it home, and
short track for a big day of podcast.
Correct. So I bolt and I'm like at the first excuse, I'm just like, I'll go get the dogs. And then and Bonnie's just like, oh, hey, she calls and she's like, don't forget to get dog food. Are you already there? And I was like, no, I'm at the warehouse. And she's like, all right. And then
you don't have to tell this story.
I do. And so it's like I leave the warehouse, I go get the dogs or whatever, and then as I'm going to pick up the dogs, Bonnie texts. Hell, I may have the text.
Oh boy, Brian is picking up his phone.
Bonnie,
so you're wait. Let's just lay this out here. You've spent the last several days in a family vacation with not only your three daughters and wife, but also your grandparents. Meanwhile, you've got an injury to your hand that extends is that your primary hand? Is that your right hand?
Yeah, it's my right hand, and for a week I've had to keep it straight. And then like over the weekend I'm barely able to bend it. I can make it like halfway down before it starts to hurt too bad. It's swollen, thick like a sausage. And then that sounded different than I meant it. Eventually, it's now at the point where I can ask, where is Pointer? And
gotcha. What you're saying is, on two different levels, for a week and change, you have not had full private use of your primary hand. Note for the record that he did not answer the question.
Bonnie texts me at 11:53. So what do you do when you run off to the warehouse? Warehouse was not on the menu.
Yeah, I'm like, what are you doing up there, by the way? Because
and I say,
no, whoa.
Was Max working that day?
That's what I'm wondering.
I was going to check on operations.
Hold on. Before we get to Brian's reaction, let's go ahead and investigate this Bonnie side. Because, Bonnie, a warehouse is really just the answer to that question, right? A warehouse is a place of business. There's mailing and sorting and planning. Mm-hmm. Maybe even just a slow walking through all the inventory, just so that the businessman can grok business things. Brian had to be out there a lot for it to warrant such a direct question.
Oh, just in general?
Max Trollbot says it's the best little warehouse in Texas.
What was the pattern of behavior? How much time was Brian spending at the warehouse, and in what intervals that made you ask that question?
Yeah, was this a cumulative thing where you're just like, what's he so worried about?
Yeah, I was just like, well, Max isn't there today, and, you know, he was just going to go pick up them dogs, and he's got a lot to do, so...
So Bonnie says, so what do you do when you run off to the warehouse? And I respond... Today I needed a little alone time. Unrelatedly, did you know that it's been 11 days since I injured my finger and can now form a fist with my right hand?
Christ on a cracker. A, at 11 days, I'd say, I'm going to need a workaround. I'm going to need a hot fix for this.
All right. Look, there may have been some patchwork solutions that we don't need to get into. There may have been what I like to call it.
What you
there.
Are saying to Bonnie is the old you can't see me five knuckle shuffle.
Wait, are you calling me a patchwork solution?
No, okay, well, all right, first of all, you're the snatchwork solution.
Oh my God. All right, wow, wait. Brian. Hold on. Everybody here needs to cool out. I have some questions. Hey.
Okay. In the 11 days, there was one delightful evening with Bonnie.
Now this includes
Not that question. I don't want answers to that question.
Okay, no. But there was also one night called the patient assistance. Where
stop!
It's the story of two characters, one of which has to teach the other. And they work together.
All right.
Oh, wait. I'm sorry. I just realized people are asking if Bryce.
No, I did not.
God, no. I was referring to.
That title. You have actual people that are not metaphorical that have that title.
Okay. Sorry. Sorry.
You can't just say, like, I call this parable of Sherryzada the Bryce Castillo.
Oh, my God.
No. Tale as old as time. Brian, when you get that question, which is, what do you do at the warehouse? How is the answer not on just... Look at boxes.
I mean, that's the problem.
No answer that's wrong.
Max needed me.
No answer that's wrong. My point is not to lie to your wife, but just that you don't need to say, I don't know, cranking out a seed.
All right, so real quick, that's the rub, is so to speak. All right, as far as I know, I don't think I've ever lied to Bonnie. There are a few questions I hope Bonnie never gets around to asking, but... like at bachelor parties or whatever.
What?
We went to titty bars.
Wow, you're the worst!
This is awful! What the fuck?
My point
Mr.
is...
Mr. Social Engineer can't lie.
I can't. It's like,
no,
I live...
No, it's not even lying. It's like actively, like, steering Bonnie to truths that they would probably both agree they don't need to know.
This is how bad I am. It's like, I would rather do all the time for all the crimes immediately than actually lie, right? And so as a result, it's like, I could, in that moment... it was clear that Bonnie was like, that's very odd. You said you were picking up the dogs and you're at the warehouse. Why are you at the warehouse is what she said. And it's like, I can. And I was like, well, what's something that I did that was productive? And I'm like, well, I can't even call it reproductive anymore.
Not when you're firing that super soaker at the bathroom wall.
So you're at the point where you know that you don't want to lie to Bonnie.
Yes.
But you also don't want to say, hey, I need to wank because I've been around the kids all, like, for the past week. And
yes.
It's a day off, so the house is full of, like, a million six-year-olds.
Yes, and realizing I can either manufacture a story that will probably be crappy and sow seeds of doubt into our relationship, or I could share an awkward truth that will probably end up being the first act of next week's Night Attack. Huh.
Wonder which one he chose.
Bonnie,
mm-hmm.
compared to the answer that you got, if yeah. Brian had just said, check an inventory, would that have been a better answer, all things considered?
I think it would have if he just said, wink. I don't know. Or, you know, oh, but like, we didn't need, like, you know.
Hold on.
Bonnie's problem is in the very mechanical definition of how much you got into, why you couldn't jerk off, and how much you were excited to jerk off today.
My roundabout metaphor was not on the nose enough. Was it winky enough? I thought.
So, Bonnie, wait, what was your reaction to that text? Was it like, I get it, whatever? Like, was it like, shame on you? Or like,
okay,
well, you
actually her response is, all and right. I believe this was typed before I finished my response.
Speaking for your
she
wife.
She says, what are you doing alone up there? Winky smiley emoji.
Oh, boy.
Wait, hold on. So she hit you with that before the what do you do when you're at the warehouse thing?
No,
after.
It came. It was like the next little, like, yeah. as he's composing. Because I'm just like,
yeah.
what the?
So did you already, yeah. okay, like you were making a joke, like, have a little alone time here. And then halfway through you composing
it, meanwhile, Brian's
I go,
like,
I needed alone time.
Like, meanwhile, it was on the third pump when I really achieved structural integrity on the on the pointer finger. That, you know, the amazing work of the human flesh to repair itself is something that I became well aware of while I was janking my shaft.
The history of warehouse jerking.
The history of warehouse wanks is as long as time itself.
So I'd like to just posit a statement that requires absolutely no response from anybody on this podcast.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
The warehouse doesn't have, like, a bed or blankets.
It's got a bathroom. And Bonnie had the same question. She's like, what if somebody else comes to the warehouse?
Which happens
frequently.
You're in
the bathroom.
Yeah.
Yes,
like
exactly.
People,
oh.
People pop in. Is that part of the allure for you, Brian?
Oh, right. No. There is nobody that's worked
okay,
in a warehouse. Right.
Oh,
that
the cleaning
got,
lady
got,
popped
not,
in.
Not fired a warning shot in that bathroom.
Okay.
Oh, boy.
All right.
Is this...
We're done. Living right
are we,
along.
Are
bum,
we? Because
bum, bum,
because
bum,
Bonnie
bum,
writes,
bum.
What if somebody shows up? And then I wrote, Jesus, I'm not a savage. I pooped to ward off evil spirits first.
That's so oversharing.
No? Too much? Okay. Anyway.
Too much.
I took a dump at the warehouse. That's the story.
Well.
Number one.
Number one.
Patreon.com/Night Attack is where you can support this very show, man. Head on over there right now. Kick us a few shekels. Do whatever you want, man. We just did a killer, I think, a killer pre-show. It was super great. You can get that early if you are a patron. And, thank you to everybody who has supported us.
Award-winning podcast.
War-winning podcast, baby.
Don't
and
we have
of course,
a bit?
Yeah, we do.
If you either become a new patron or adjust your pledge upward during the week, you put yourself in the running for the...
Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the Night Attack new Patreon name chant corner hour.
An hour of it. And the big name is loading very slowly on Gmail because
just make sure you up your pledge sometime, and there's a good chance you might get your name shouted out right here on this part of the show where we separate acts one and two.
Oh my
and I'm
God.
Really ready for
thank
the separation
you for pointing wow. out the structural integrity of the Patreon plug. We make sure that we pay tribute to those that support us by honoring them. Brian, where do you think this listener is going to hear this right now?
I don't know. I'm looking at a picture of him. This one's got a picture on his profile, and he looks majestic. Eyes pointed upward toward the sky at a two-thirds profile, like Superman, but only he's Clark Kent because he's wearing sunglasses, and his beard is reddish. And I don't know what he's doing right now, but I hope he's weirded out when I say hello, Stuart Moore.
Stuart Moore.
Yo,
Stuart Moore.
Hey. You're needed at the warehouse. Get over there.
Oh, sorry.
All right.
And bring the Windex, Stuart.
All right. Hey, man, we got a game we're playing tonight.
We got a game.
Yep, and Brian's ready to grip it fully.
All right. Remember the separation?
Each victory.
They're the United Acts of Night Attack. There's a reason they signed an Articles of Confederation that respects their borders.
Mm-hmm. So this
all
is...
right. All right. Yeah, that's fine.
So this is apologizing.
We all know that Brian will go first because the number two usually shows up before when it comes to the warehouse.
So this is apologizes for. You guys played this about.
Welcome to the Come Free Act 2, says Sunbun.
All right, so.
No more of it.
So welcome to Apologizes for. This is a game you guys probably played about a year ago. We got. Let me check and get the right number. We got over 150 headlines from people over the past 2 days. People were ready for it, of people, businesses apologizing for the shameful things that they've done.
Yes. By the way, if you want to treat yourself, set yourself up a Google News feed that only sends you headlines that have the exact phrase, quote, apologizes for, end quote. And it's awesome. It's awesome, awesome, awesome. And I haven't looked in a while, and we forgot about the bit. And so Neshcon put this together for us. Our job is to take the rest of the headline and figure out what's missing, right?
Yeah. So I'm going to give you both. So you both, this is different from last year. You're both going to play each round. I'm going to give you a headline. So, for example, Justin Timberlake finally apologizes for blank. Brian would give a guess. Justin
wardrobe
would guess.
Malfunction, I would guess.
Okay, Justin would guess.
Oh, no, there's something more recent with him.
Shitty
and I think
albums.
It was, racist tweet, a racial tweet, mm-hmm. racial controversy.
And then using very scientific methods, a.k.a. my own decision, whoever is closest is going to get the point. So Brian would actually get the point because the headline is Justin Timberlake apologizes for NSYNC's terrible outfits.
Oh,
what?
That's a real corkscrew. Why? That's a real corkscrew.
That's funny. Good.
Remember
one.
The 90s?
Yeah, but like, oh, was he in?
He was in NSYNC.
Oh, why?
Yeah,
he
was. He was the cute one.
He was in it.
He was in it, and they did. It would be the equivalent of Brian apologizing for his majestic fucking crown he used to wear on his head.
It was majestic.
Yeah, and those high water pants.
Yeah. Okay. Well, there's that.
Did you have high water?
Oh, you don't remember the human crazy straw video? I had them strapped around my belly. I think my belly button was below the belt for some reason.
Oh yeah. No. Brian would unzip to show his belly button to people with as high as those pants.
Like, I think this is roughly what it looks like.
Oh my goodness, the buckle is so high.
Give or take.
We're gonna need NASA. These are like the worst version of this is why there are no dad jeans. Mom jeans like could kind of work. This is not anything.
All right, hey, real quick before we get into the game, yeah. I'm gonna just go ahead and acknowledge it. I know we try not to break the flow of the show, but there's been four or five people that are in the chat right now that are begging and pleading for me to turn on this Night Attack sign. That I have not turned on in probably
a while.
50 or 60 episodes.
Well, because it
right?
blows out the shot and
it
looks terrible.
It blows out the shot, right?
Yeah.
I'm just going to say this. Right now, our Patreon is at $15.92. Mm. We get to $1,600. I'll turn it on the side.
You know what? That's the new, that's the new reward. And in fact, and we've talked about this before, you could get tint to just place over that so it can be on all the time and you can reduce the amount of light going through and it won't blow out the shot. We'll invest in that if only we had 1600.
There we go. All right. So there we go. If you want it, you got it. 1600. Let's play the game.
All right. Let's play Apologizes for...
I didn't know I couldn't do that.
All right. We're going to start with this headline. Walmart apologizes for blank in Valentine's display. We're going to start with Brian. Walmart apologizes for blank in Valentine's display. We're going to give you a hint. This is from the year 2017.
Okay. Walmart. Well, last time I saw Walmart apologizing for a product display was when somebody had literally made Twin Towers out of Coca-Cola products.
Oh, I do remember that.
On 9/11. That's a real thing. You can find that and show it should you like to. So I'm going to say, because they have leeway with what they do on the display.
Sure. It's up to the different stores to kind of decide what feels right for, you know, the area.
I'm going
to
say it was.
And, and that's something that that person in September, the manager at that store, never forgot.
Okay. I'm going to say that it was an overly suggestive sexual image in their Valentine's
Day. I'm going to need to make a decision on what that is. Is it a, naked lady? Is it a
No, I'm sure it looked like two people having sex.
Okay. Justin, Walmart apologizes for blank in Valentine's Day.
I mean, because I was going to say porn. Mm-hmm. I was just going to say that somehow, some way, the some porn ass stuff wound up in that Walmart, but because they wouldn't get in trouble for lingerie, would they?
I mean, they sell.
They sell lingerie. Like something that you kind of want to bang somebody in, right? Like,
I don't think possibly. So.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, Walmart,
I think that's how they market it too. They're all like,
you'll want to maybe bang someone.
Like, I don't know. You maybe hit this question mark and an arrow pointing at it.
The Hanes.
By the
question
way, that's
mark
their
line.
Best-selling Valentine. It's just, would you hit this?
Question mark.
I am going to say porn. I mean, I'm just let's start out. We got a bunch of them to go. I know that we're in similar territory, but I'm going to say porn.
Okay. Walmart apologized for condoms in their Valentine's display. I think I'm going to go with Brian on that because porn is a very concrete thing where, like, I imagine.
Yeah, it is.
I imagine, like, in Justin's answer, it was, like, Playboys. But right. In yours
it was the
answer,
overly suggestive.
Like, Coca-Cola boxes in the shape of people just
having sex, yeah. Implied sex, not explicit.
As if Georgia O'Keeffe was organizing a Coca-Cola display.
Right. All right, well, let's get to the next apologizes for.
I didn't know I couldn't do that.
TV's Steve Harvey apologizes for offensive joke about blank. Justin, we're going to start with you. This is from 2017.
Ooh, my.
Steve Harvey.
Offensive joke about Trump.
Offensive joke about Trump. All right. Brian?
I'm going to go more general and say Republicans.
Oh, interesting. Turns out
this is the equivalent of bidding $1. I just realized.
Exactly.
I'm being that
like,
asshole.
I'm going to go a little bit more general really and say mammals.
I think it was.
Sorry. I do think it's about.
I think it was breastfeeding, but go ahead.
Yeah. Oh, you want in?
You want to play, Bonnie?
You want in?
I'm going to say it's breastfeeding.
All right. Brian, we need.
I mean, I'm sticking with Republicans, but I just realized all of a sudden Justin and I are practically in the same zip code, and Bonnie's claimed the other half of the United States.
Oh, yeah. Oh, God, no. She's just squirting her mother's milk everywhere with this.
All right. Well, Steve Harvey apologized for an offensive joke about Asian men.
Oh, my God. By the way, I wish the camera was still on me because here's what happened. Slow motion. If you're like, a joke about Asian men. Like, I definitely snapped
also,
right.
Also, bring that. Did you still have that thing? Bring that thing back up because there's one of them right behind him.
Yeah.
That's really pissed off.
That's right.
He's like, what the? What are you doing talking shit, Steve? I heard what you said.
Is there a copy of the joke?
Should that's be. Just spreading poor taste.
Right. Well, I mean, but also, just, it's also right. documenting but history, Bonnie. We got to tell the truth.
Oh, yeah, Bonnie, if you were to imagine what the joke would be, like, what would you
we don't into that. I'm not.
All right. You're not going to step into that rice paddy?
God.
No.
All right.
I think
calm
that was the
down,
that was
PewDiePie.
The... PewDiePie.
Oh, oh man. God. All you YouTube celebrities with your cut-up comedy.
It's just a joke.
You want to head on over to Fiverr?
Let's have a bunch of Fiverr people hold up a sign that says, I'm a YouTube comedian, huh?
All right. All right, let's go to the next round.
I didn't know I couldn't do that.
London Cafe apologizes for smoothie with blank on the label. Bonnie, we're going to start with you. London Cafe apologizes for smoothie with blank on the label. This is from 2016.
I just saw... the look, the facial expression that happens when 27 things you can't say pop into your mind.
Yeah, they all ran through. I'm going to say breastfeeding again.
All right, with breastfeeding. You know, it's a still kind of stigmatized. Sure, sure.
What? One more time?
London Cafe apologizes for smoothie with blank on the label.
By the way, Bonnie, that's the last breastfeeding answer you get.
Okay.
It's the answer for everything, and you can't hide behind those tits no more.
I'm gonna go a little more general and say some bodily fluid.
By the way, my scientific method discounts you lose points for being too
general. Okay, all right. I'm gonna say one more time the exact phrasing.
London Cafe apologizes for smoothie with blank on the label.
Man, I do think it. You know what? I'm gonna say a booger. Booger.
Wait, I got an idea.
A booger. Okay.
Yeah, with snot.
A booger is gonna be something where that gets a bad Yelp review. Like, no one's calling into the Times of London and saying, like, "Oh, jolly chap, you should see the smoothie with the booger on the label."
All right, listen.
Okay, I got an idea.
On the advice of my counsel, Whistle034 in the Twitch chat. I'm going to go a little more general and go with matter. Like, I think there was matter of some variety on the label.
All right. Justin, London Cafe apologizes for smoothie with blank on the label.
So I'm almost positive it's got to be either a swastika or blackface. And I want to say...
Oh.
Okay, a swastika I can understand with it. It's a festive decorative design that happens to, if you look at it askance, look like a swastika. How does blackface accidentally end up on a label?
Oh, no. I think it's just like it's... And I'm going to self-edit what kinds of smoothies I think that they would put that label on. Specific flavors. But I will say it's a joke gone wrong. It's somebody trying to be super clever, and it turns out that they're not clever, and it turns out that it's offensive. Like, I think that's... Much like this bit, it's going to be really funny until it's not.
So what is your answer? Did you decide?
I'm going to go Nazi, some Nazi thing.
All right. A London Cafe has apologized for a smoothie with a swastika on the label. The smoothie is called Nutsy.
Oh, Nutsy. Dear.
Because it contains almond milk, peanut butter, banana, and honey.
Those things all have something in common. Hey, Justin, they're all...
allergies.
By the way, I love that whenever... You know, I think everybody who's gone through these you ever hear these, SJWs, these social justice warriors? Hmm. They got it all wrong. They're trying to affect change in the world by hectoring people and telling everybody, like, oh, you're bad. You should just do it like us. whenever you feel that you are in a position that is either indicative of your whiteness or put in privilege by your whiteness, you just imagine Brian and I as vengeful specters just slowly coming up over your over either shoulder, just whispering in your ear.
Hey, by the way, of all the countries, you would think that they get the right to make that joke.
England?
Yeah.
To make Nazi jokes?
Yeah. They get bombed. Them in France. Them in France and Poland get to make all the Nazi jokes they want.
Is it really a joke, though?
Let's toss Israel in there just to be on the safe side.
Wait,
like,
which
we don't
one?
Need to be stingy.
Oh, and Norway. Norway. Hitler's teeth were the did I ever tell you about this? When we lived in Norway, there was pillboxes all along the beach, and we would play in them, and they were called Hitler's teeth, and I didn't really understand what that meant at the time. And though when they were invaded and occupied by Germany, they built pillboxes because they thought that this was where the Normandy invasion was going to happen, and they were prepped for it. And they were still there in 1987 when I played on them.
Wow.
It's weird.
What's all right. Box?
Tell you what, that Hitler man, hell of a set of teeth.
All right, let's go to another round of apologizes for...
I didn't know I couldn't do that.
A magician apologizes for blank trick on teacher. This is from 2011. Magician apologizes for blank trick on teacher, I believe... Brian, you're going to start with this one.
Knife.
Okay, Brian says knife. Justin, noted magician journalist.
Man, there is only one trick, if it's not offensive, that you have to apologize for. I'm gonna go ahead and say knife in paper bag.
No.
I'm going. All right,
it is more specific.
One farther than Brian.
Actually, hold on. Actually,
I got
if
it.
You want that territory, I'll back up and I'll pick another. I actually have. I realize what it is.
You can't take mine.
Oh, okay. You're
going to
get this
first.
One. You're going to get this one. Damn it,
Bonnie. What's up?
Wand.
No, you're both wrong. You're both wrong.
It's the wand through teacher.
There's one mass marketed trick that universally invites discussion, and it's the bra trick. It's 20th century silks with the bra. You tuck the two scarves into the chest, and when you pull them out, there's a bra in there. It's a bra trick. Bra trick.
Yeah, I think you're right.
Brian, you're exactly right. Man, magician apologizes for trick that pretended to rip teacher's bra off at public business meeting. It was a bra trick. It was that exact one.
Yeah.
Good job.
Oh, dude, that is you absolutely nailed that one. And by the way, it was perfectly charming when David Copperfield did it on television, and then all of a sudden, Shlubbo McFartfart, the random Denny's magician, tries to do it to your grandma, and you're like, "What the fuck, bro? We're ready to fight."
Hey, man, you may be Shlubbo McFartfart, but that's my grandma, and this ain't your Denny's, man.
Hey, it's Shlubbo McFartfart, huh? Who's got a dollar? Give it to me with your hand. The clean one.
This is. I want to see his ad. It's a Shlubbo McFartfart.
I'm available for bar mitzvahs, parties, Denny's, Chili's, Buffalo Wild Wings, all the hot gigs. Hey everybody! All right, we're over 1600, so 1600. Here we go.
Yeah.
Hit that light. Here it goes.
Here we go. Hey, look at that.
Justin, that's a little bit blown out.
You're kind of blown out.
I don't know. I kind of wish you hadn't turned it on. Plus, also, like the refresh rate is screwing with. It's sort of flickering.
What do you say we just turn on this?
The little one?
Oh.
These are from BioCow. Fantastic.
We'll just turn on
that. That's great.
Well, it's hard to tell that it's turned on with the other one so turned on.
You want to turn off?
I don't know how I feel about this.
Well, hold on.
But
say we've already lost. We lost the money. It's the moment you turned it off.
The money
turn
went
it back
away.
On.
Oh my God! It was contingent the whole time.
Yeah. Turn it back on. Turn it back on. There you go. All right. I am messing with this voodoo. Let's leave it on.
So no. By the way, at 1700, we'll turn it off.
All right, let's do another round of apologizes for.
I didn't know I couldn't do that.
This is from 2009. New York Post apologizes for, yet still defends, blank. Justin, you're going first on this time. New York Post apologizes for, yet still defends, blank. New York Post apologizes.
So normally, all right. So normally with journalism stuff, it's a slanderous story that you're apologizing for, a libelous story, I guess, in a newspaper's case. So I'm going to say, but do I don't know what I'm going to go. Pictures. Some pictures that were run that were embarrassing or something like that.
That's actually I like the way you tackled this. Okay, but real quick, read it one more time.
New York Post apologizes for, yet still defends, blank.
Oh, no, I
and
got
what,
this one.
What year was it?
This is from 2009.
2009. And still defends...
blank.
Blank. And it's one word that we're missing?
I can't tell you that.
Oh.
I'm so sorry. Bonnie's
like, I thought we were friends. Oh. I tell you things all the time. You won't tell me? What is this?
Don't get jealous, Brian.
Okay.
New York Post apologizes for, yet still defends, blank.
I think chart.
Chart.
A chart.
Okay. Chart. All right. So we've got pictures and a chart.
Brian.
It's an op-ed.
Okay.
They ran an op-ed.
This is the Post. Do you think that the Post has an editorial board?
I don't know. We're about to find out, aren't we?
All right. The New York Post apologizes for, yet still defends, chimp cartoon. Political cartoon is an image of a monkey shot twice in the chest on the ground, bleeding out.
Jeez.
With the cop saying they'll have to find someone else to write that next stimulus bill. So.
Oh, my God.
Why would they defend that?
It's not a good look.
What they're saying is that the stimulus bill was so poorly written, it might as well have been done by the room full of apes typing Shakespeare, right?
Mm-hmm.
But this is what happens. Here's a little song for everybody who works in the newspaper industry. Hire non-whites. Hire non-whites.
Yes!
We'll tell you you're not right when you're running something offensive that you will not use with your white sight.
With your white sight. Yeah. It's like you roll a character. It's like, well, the good news you rolled a white person. Good news is you're in this class. The bad news is you have white sight. Oh, what's white sight? It blinds you from when you're horrifically offensive to vast swaths of people.
Just kind of helps out. And sometimes it even feels wrong to randomly show minority members of your staff certain things. But you want to know what? It'll be better in the end. It'll be better in the end if a wider patchwork of colors sees what happens.
Okay.
All right, you guys ready for the last three?
Hold on. Who won that one?
Oh, Justin won that
yeah,
one.
Yeah, that's a
pictures,
picture. That's definitely pictures, a picture.
Oh, yeah.
All right.
Way to go.
Although technically, I mean, it's content written by an outside, No.
All right, this is your final three. Pol Pot men say sorry for blank. This is from 1998.
Oh, no.
Pol Pot men say sorry for blank. Pol Pot men, multiples, plural, say sorry for blank.
Okay, hold on, real quick. Did he call his troop the Pol Pot men?
This was the 90s.
No!
Like, did Hitler call? He's like, now, all my Hitler people, go forth and do Hitler stuff.
No.
It just sounds like something that you would yell before a dance break, right? Like, now you have to answer to the Pol Pot men. Salute!
Yeah. Pol Pot men say sorry for blank. Bonnie, I believe, is starting this one.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
It's rough when I gotta start. I just say boobs.
Breast milk? Is that what you want to say?
Okay, Okay.
This is from
1998. For Pol Pot men apologize for poorly written pop song.
All right, that's an answer, surely. Brian, Pol Pot men say sorry for blank.
Crazy idea. Massacre. I'm just going to go with massacre.
Interesting direction.
They're sorry for the massacre. Actually, I don't think hold on.
Or were they?
Hold on. Mm-hmm. Oh. Pol Pot Men sounds like it might have been a band name.
That's what I was saying.
In the late 90s.
That's what I was saying.
So you're just going to say for name.
For their name.
Pol Pot Men say sorry for their name.
Yeah. Yeah.
Pol Pot Men apologize for name.
For their name. For being, for naming themselves.
You win.
I'm a Pol Pot Man, and I'm here to say it's fun to kill people every day. Justin, what's your answer? Pol Pot Men say sorry for blank.
Pol Pot Men apologize to Pol Pot women for spending suspiciously too much time at the warehouse.
There was a separation between the first act
and the second act. Have a very specific membrane that you cannot pierce. Right.
Sorry, I'm just trying to get. I don't remember what happened in '98. Pol Pot Men apologize. For music video.
I love the fact that you adopted the same narrative. You've decided, we all three have decided that they're definitely a band.
This is Justin's $1 for your answer.
Just like Bonnie and I have set up shop in Washington, D.C. Justin has set up shop in Fairfax.
Carson Daly is reviewing all the new videos that are coming in. It's like, oh, here's that new single by the Pol Pot Men. Nothing weird about that. And then watches like, oh my God, this video by noted recording artist, the Pol Pot Men, has really crossed a line.
So Justin, your answer is music video.
Music video.
Brian, your answer is name.
Their name, yes.
And Bonnie, your name is breast milk?
Your name
No, I don't get to
milk.
Use that one anymore.
Did you even realize you said Bonnie, your name is breast milk?
Hi, my name is... My name is...
What?
Breast milk.
Breast milk.
I'm sorry.
Bonnie, your name is breast milk.
Breast milk. I heard your kid cry in the...
I'm sorry. I was just checking everybody's answer. Bonnie, you said... what did you say again?
Letdown. That's a breast milk joke.
Letdown.
You had to explain.
Let's follow this. Okay. It's been a while. But if we got a freestyle track, can we get the MC Allergy breast milk track?
Yeah. Give me a beat.
Oh yeah, no, we need something to prime.
Well, here, let's get through the Pol Pot Men here.
Okay.
I just wanted to confirm your answer as
I said it was for the poppy, for the catchy, poorly written catchy tune, was what they were apologizing for.
We're now assuming that they are definitely a band, and it's just what they got in trouble for.
All right. Well. The Pol Pot Men have said sorry for the Killing Fields.
God damn it! I should have gone. I should have stuck with Massacre.
I don't know why this narrative even existed. There's no band called the Pol Pot Men. It's not. Southern California didn't have that much tolerance in the 90s for a band called the Pol Pot Men. I just don't think.
How did I land on
the two gave a.
I could have swore, man. I went to a Lollapalooza that was Sonic Youth, Mudhoney, and the Pol Pot Men.
It was the 1990s.
I don't know how.
It's closer to the
Bonnie started this band fever that got me to give up Massacre as my answer.
Yeah.
I'd be like, oh, no, it's not Massacre. It's their name.
By the way, X Modem in the Twitch chat does point out that maybe the Killing Fields was their worst album. You never
That's
thought.
What I'm saying.
That's I'm giving no points for that. That's so far off.
It's the
science can't discern it.
It's the all right. It's the poppy tune they're apologizing for.
All right.
Oh my god.
All right, last two.
All right, good. No, good.
After 15 years, actor apologizes for blank. We're gonna start with Brian. This is from 1996. After 15 years, actor apologizes for blank.
1981. Little early for it to be a sex tape.
Okay.
Just put that on my gravestone. Sure. 1981 is a little early for a sex tape. Geez. What could you do?
In 1981?
After 15 years of defying...
That would have been 1960-something?
No. This took place in 1996.
Oh.
After 15 years.
After 15 years.
Actor apologizes for blank.
Whatever he did, and also, this is a time... Mid-90s was back when they would make the designation of actors and actresses. So I'm going to guess it's a male.
So it is from 96.
I'm going to say apologizes for racial remark.
Racial remark.
Well, the history of celebrity sex tapes can be traced back to 1981.
Yeah.
All right, Justin, after...
Hold on. Well, that would also be a very fashionable time to apologize for specifically homophobic comments. I'm going to switch not a racist comment, a homophobic comment or action.
All right. I am going to say it is. I'm gonna go blackface. I'm gonna go a racially insensitive role.
Oh, you're taking. Do you want massacre for this one? Because maybe I was right twice on that one.
Oh, now, man, that sounds really good, Justin.
Bonnie.
Yeah, I think it's somebody who played somebody that, like, 15 years later, it's like, oh, geez, turns out. In the intervening decade and a half, I made a black friend, and he was not pleased with that role of mine.
Interesting. Bonnie, after 15 years.
I'm just sold on Justin's. I'm gonna bet with the dollar and say it was a mentally handicapped person that they played. Because that was also popular.
Okay.
No. But that was full throttle in the late 90s. Like, that was a boom time for that.
Yeah.
We're still 5 years away from I Am Sam.
Real quick, before we get to the answer,
okay.
Which way would you rule between Justin saying wearing blackface and me saying homophobia or whatever? Where does, like, let's say it was Dustin Hoffman apologizes for dressing like a woman in Tootsie, which would have been around that same time.
Oh, interesting.
Which one of us would have, in the judge's ruling, gotten that one?
In the judge's ruling between blackface and homophobic slurs, I'd probably say blackface because that's an impersonation act.
Yeah. Oh, wow. I would have went homophobic slur.
Mm, but I got science on my side.
Yeah.
After 15 years, actor apologizes for blank. So we've all settled in, right?
Yep.
Brian, you've said... blackface? Is that right?
No.
You said homophobic slurs.
I said yes. For saying something homophobic.
Justin said blackface, and then Bonnie was about to give her answer.
So I can't do the dollar?
Mentally handicapped.
Oh, mentally handicapped.
Mentally handicapped.
Yeah.
Yep.
All right. Well, take it to the bank, boys. After 15 years, actor Eddie Murphy apologizes for gay slurs.
Oh! Gay slurs! Sorry.
Really?
No.
Well, I guess he did all those comedy albums.
Measured celebration.
Yeah. This is where we all are like, well, I'm not thrilled that it happened, but I am glad that finally we brought some balance to the equation with me winning this point.
I mean, listen, a doctor doesn't fist pump when they find somebody has cancer, right? Like,
All right.
Just like, carcinoma.
Oh, no. By the way, man, Eddie Murphy, can we talk about Eddie Murphy's album in 1980 where it's like he simultaneously drops all these gay slurs, but then does a song called Boogie in Your Butt that's about shoving stuff up your butt?
What?
Yeah.
Yeah, do you know this song?
I guess I do know the song.
Yeah, okay, all right.
Played it a lot.
All right. I heard this just... one about right, a warehouse. What, how does that song go, Brian?
This is oh, hey, there's a separation. There's a membrane between
there's a
the
membrane.
First act and the second act.
Yeah. That's right.
But
that's
also,
right.
If there was going to be a song, like we'd be like, buy the Pol Pot Man.
It would be like.
No, never get... mind. I don't want to hear it. I really, all right. really don't want to hear the...
All right, going into the last question, Brian has 3 points. Justin has 3 points. Bonnie has 0. Suspiciously, this last question is for 4 points.
Oh, my God. 4 billion
points?
4 billion
points.
Oh,
billion points.
Right. Oh, my God. 4 billion points. This is
so
the one.
Anybody's game. Now, this was going to be a little specific, so I'm gonna give you – I'm almost going to give you the answer, but I'm going to need a very specific – I'm going to need a very specific thing from each of you guys. Misspelled note on pickup apologizes for anger blank. Misspelled note on pickup apologizes for anger blank. So whenever – so I will say this is a one-word answer. I'm going to need your spelling of the answer. One last time, misspelled note on pickup apologizes for anger blank. We are going to start with Justin. Justin.
I didn't know I couldn't do that.
Misspelled note on pickup apologizes for
anger
blank.
Blank. So I'm gonna need what you think it is and your spelling, because we have science
of what was misspelled.
Of your answer, is what I'll say. The answer will be misspelled, so I want how you would spell it. Misspelled note on pickup apologizes for anger blank.
Oh man, I don't even know where to go with this. I'm glad I go first because I'll be the first one to take the South Park the nagger. You know, one who nags.
Mm-hmm. Misspelled note on pickup apologizes for anger blank.
So that's what you're going with is naggers?
Is naggers?
Sure.
I'm going to need you to spell that for me, Justin, just real quick.
N-A-double-G-E-R-S.
All right. Bonnie, misspelled note on pickup apologizes for anger blank.
Display? But I don't know how to make that funny.
Display?
Display.
How do you spell dis? How do you misspell display?
D-E-S.
D-I-C-K-Z
display.
P-L-E-L
4 A's
Y-Y display. D-E-S-P-L-E-Y. I don't know.
All right. Brian, misspelled note on pickup apologizes for anger blank.
Just to be clear, I'm assuming there are quotes in this headline. Are there quotes in this headline?
Yes.
And they begin before the word anger.
And end after the blank.
Right. Okay.
Apologizes for anger blank. In fact, I should have mentioned that. So if you guys want to redo your answer.
You want to change from anger nagger?
You want to know what? I've already made my peace with how far I'm into this bog. And I'm just going to be willing to die in the reeds.
All right.
Bonnie?
You keep display.
You want management misspelled a different way?
I was gonna say management, but is there any
man? Can I ask?
That's not funny what,
can
either.
I can I ask? I'm assuming that also, and it's fine if you say you don't want to give me this.
Okay.
I'm assuming anger is spelled correctly, but only the second word is misspelled.
Anger. Actually, the note is 3 words. Anger is the second word, and anger is correctly spelled. That's what I will tell you.
Ooh.
Misspelled note on pickup apologizes for anger blank.
I'm going to say management, M-A-N-A-J-M-E-N-T.
Menagement?
Menagement. Yeah. Nicki Menagement.
Anger Menagement. Oh, also, what year was this?
2017.
Yeah, okay. Menagement.
All right. So Brian has said Menagement. Jerry said Naggers. Also, I'm just now realizing that's supposed to be misspelled. Oh, boy. And Bond says, display. Misspelled note on pickup apologizes for anger issusesh. Police say the note read, sorry, anger issusesh. I'm gonna give this one to Bonnie.
Yay!
Wow. For display. And with 4 points, I'm sorry, 4 billion points.
Oh my god,
Bonnie
Rushford
is the winner!
Congratulations, Bonnie!
Yay!
Issusesh.
Issusesh.
Hey man. I'm sorry for all those issusesh that we had to resolve, man.
Well, it happens.
I'll tell you what.
Bonnie, is that your second win in a row? Did you win last week, too?
What did I win last week?
I said what? He said what?
Is it because of the Deus
of the final round?
Machina?
Bonnie, hey, listen, all you do is win in the fourth quarter, man. That's all that matters. You come out on top.
So sweet.
Well, absolutely, yeah. No, totally.
I have to go to bed, so I'm going to take my win and just say thank you.
All right. Well, good night to Bonnie, of course, Invisible Wife. Thank you so much for being
on
a
Twitter.
Part of the show.
Yep.
Thank you so much.
That's great. We love your yawning eggs directly right
so
in the
microphone. Sorry.
That's good. Bring in the energy.
The yawning exit I saw in a porn film.
I'll tell you what.
Boy, howdy.
Hey, sorry. Never mind.
Brian, night, did gentlemen. You need a handful of tissue sesh?
I'm using a different clay today, and it was just mush. It was no good. I'll bring better clay next time.
Wait. Oh, people wanted to see what you were making. They wanted to see the pig. Okay. Oh, that's right. You're making pigs.
Yeah, I'm making stuff.
Yeah.
All right. Hey, Bonnie.
Hey, buddy. You want to take a moment to do a little diamond time?
Hell yeah, Brian. Everybody can go on over to diamondclub.reddit.com. That's where all the Diamond Club folks all gather. Top of the pops there every single week. We've got our Diamond Time submissions where we shout out any project that you guys have in the pipeline. You want us to talk about it, put it on up there. The top three are the ones that get read, including this one from MJ Audio. Hello, friends. A few months ago, I started a podcast to support the local music scene in my area. Each episode features performances and interviews with local independent bands in the South Carolina upstate. It's called the Hoodoo Music Podcast, and a new episode comes out every other week with videos in the off weeks. Some of these bands tour, so they may be playing near you sometime, and they would love to see some new faces, so why not check them out? You can find links to the show, video, and social media at Hoodoo Music Podcast or YOLO420.com/localbandswag.
Meanwhile, RM_Del Noche writes, let's kick off this year's South by So Wasted weekend with the meetup. Ritual Misery is hosting a Diamond Club meetup at Darwin's Pub on 6th Street in Austin from 4 to 7 p.m. on Thursday, March 9th. Also, Ritual Misery will attempt their first ever live show that night from 5 to 6 p.m. Join us for a fun-filled evening of shenanigans, prizes, and swag giveaways. You don't want to miss this. YOLO420.com/RMP-LIVE, all lowercase. Holy cow, dude. It's happening. It's happening. We're,
this is, I think, the second year that they have that they've done that, and it was an absolute blast last time. It'll be a great time this time. I don't know. I'm so excited. It just feels like it comes up so fast that that South by Southwest just kind of sneaks
Right? Something tells me the entirety of our after show will be figuring out where and when we're going to perform. Bryce, we'll save it for the after show. If you want to know the details, patreon.com/9.
Absolutely.
And we'll tweet out the information when we decide.
The original funky drummer for James Brown passed away on February 18th, 2017, and his family has a GoFundMe page to raise money for his memorial fund. 420.com/givethedrummersome. Clyde's drumming made him the most sampled drummer in history. However, he never received any royalties for his work. Additionally, he dealt with major health issues over the last 20 years without insurance, and it was revealed last year that Prince secretly helped to pay for some of his medical costs, which is pretty damn cool. How does this relate to Diamond Club? Well, me, that's how. I played in Clyde's band when I was living in Madison, Wisconsin. You can read about my experience at YOLO420.com Trombone Alex. Every musician that's played with Clyde throughout his years will tell you about his generosity on stage and off, and that the world is now a little less funky without him. So be as cool as Prince and check out Clyde's Memorial Fund at YOLO420.com/givethedrummersome. If you want to throw a diamond in the comments, it would mean a lot to me. Thanks, Alex Leong. That is at TromboneAlex.com. Axel Words on Twitter.
Man, that's freaking amazing. I would love to know which songs are the most sampled, if there's a follow-up or something.
A ton of James Brown. I mean, James Brown was just so intensely sampled, especially as hip-hop kind of entered into not only the heavily sampled phase, but also that kind of more funky, the G-funk, funkadelic kind of stuff in the 90s with the West Coast scene. But certainly a ton of James Brown samples out there.
Dude, that's awesome. Shall we take a minute to examine the movie draft?
Oh, indeed.
Welcome to Movie Minute, presented by CosmicRadio.tv for the week of February 20th, 2017. I'm your host, Roberto Villegas. All right, it's taken a little time, maybe more than a little time, but we finally have a new first place competitor. Who is it? Let's go find out. Mikey Newman's in sixth place with $275.2 million. Chris Gates is in fifth place, $292.7 million. Milongo AE is in fourth place, $398.2 million. Joshua Young's in third place with the Great Wall, bringing in $21.6 million, bringing his total to $462.9 million. Team DTS drops to second place with $708.5 million. And in first place, the whopping $727.8 million. It's Brian Brushwood. And that is your Movie Minute for the week of February 20th, 2017.
Dude. All right, real quick, without looking, how much money do you think Rogue One ended up with? And how much did you think it was going to end up with when we began this?
Well, when we began this, I thought it was going to be a good movie.
Right.
So I will say it ended up at $450 million.
It made $528 million.
Okay.
Number 8 buy of the draft.
Yeah, that's the weird part, is it went for a fairly correct price. Like somehow, again, that. You know, Adam Smith's magical hand shapes our movie draft and figures out what movies are worth.
I would love it so much more if he called it the magical hand instead of the invisible hand.
I love it.
It would have been so much more whimsical, you know? Like
as written by Doug Henning, it's just like, free markets are magic. Woo! It's magic.
I would love it. The super hardcore Ayn Rand version of Doug Henning.
The magic show. He's just like,
as you see, the capital controls needs of paper.
No, I totally expected a lot more than we saw there. That was pretty amazing.
Well, because you thought that it was going to do better than Episode 7.
I didn't think that. What did Episode 7 make? Like 800 million? Or it didn't make a billion domestic, right?
No.
It was 700 million. It was close to, it was
a lot. It was like 700 something. I mean, and that's the top. That's the highest grossing.
Yeah, I did think that it was going to be around that same thing, and I thought it had a chance, like you said, to be good. And then total domestic gross $936 million, this close to a billion.
Yeah,
that's what I was expecting, and we didn't get that.
And then meanwhile, I mean, like, because like Doctor Strange wound up doing really well. It was like 400 or something, right?
Yeah,
like
super super good. Man, yeah, I guess
the Doctor Strange is at 232.
Oh, 232. Sorry. 17. Oh, I guess it was five and change with the worldwide. But yeah, mm-hmm. You know, I mean, so basically, Rogue One was two Doctor Stranges.
That don't seem right. Doctor Strange was twice as good as Rogue One.
Well, I mean, one had Star Wars on it.
Yeah,
and the other was about Doctor Strange.
All right, let's talk about the elephant in the room.
Like, yeah.
You check out those Rotten Tomatoes ratings on Logan. the movie that you said was not going to make any money because it was another superhero movie and it was the fourth movie in a dying franchise of Wolverine movies.
Again, my point has never been that it's not going to be great. Yeah. I think it's going to be really, really good. My point is always is just that it would have done this. Logan 2, now he's even older, will gross more if it is as good as Logan 1 than Logan 1 will, because it does not have the specter of like crappy Wolverine movies that came out 2 years ago to contend with.
Well, so
and Logan is following X-Men Apocalypse, which was very middle of the road.
Right. It is, but they've done a good job of marketing it as standalone, possibly Splinter Universe, you know, individual reimagining of Sideways, whatever. Like, knowing that the reviews are this positive, mm-hmm. do you want to revise your estimate on how much Logan's going to make?
What did I say it was?
What you said it was going to do about what, possibly less than the previous Wolverine movies had done.
Which was what, 100 something?
I think 200. Our crack producer's looking it up right now.
What was the last one called?
Just type in Wolverine. I think
the Wolverine.
Yeah,
I believe
the Wolverine, and then there's Wolverine.
The Wolverine got 132 million domestic, twice that in foreign.
Are you still feeling like that's the neighborhood that Logan lives in?
That was 4 years.
I think that we're also now we're making different bets, because wasn't the bet last time that it was going to be like the highest? You thought it was going to be like the highest R-rated opening ever?
No, I
remember a week ago we were looking up Deadpool like opening week.
Yeah, no. I definitely do feel like that's the neighborhood it's going to live in. Deadpool
says the over under was 195.
Yes, that I still stand by that. I'm still the over, and you were the under. Are you still the under?
In the first month is what we're talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah, I will go under 195.
Wow. Wow. Okay. All right. Wow. Wow. Huh.
So you think it'll be that much bigger than Doctor Strange, which made 200?
Yes.
In its entire run?
Yes, I do. I do. I do. It's a different category altogether, and the buzz is better than Doctor Strange, and it's from the same progeny as Deadpool. What did Deadpool do? We'll find that out shortly.
But Deadpool was insane. But I guess that's it. I mean, Deadpool really, this is where the rubber's going to meet the road.
So Deadpool. So this movie can make 60% of Deadpool and still beat the over.
But that's the highest. Like, that's the most successful R-rated movie, literally of all time.
Correct. That's the neighborhood this lives.
Also,
in.
It was a big, funny, silly movie with an insane. Like ad campaign that led up to it, and I think way more buzz than what we're getting for Logan. I mean, Logan's big in our circles, but I don't know how much Ashley knows about Logan.
Ashley
was begging to go see Deadpool.
Yeah, you might be right. I honestly don't know. Max Trollbot points out that Deadpool made money because people gave a shit about it, not because it was an R-rated superhero movie. I would say the exact same thing is true in Logan. I don't know, man. The buzz is insane.
The last X-Men movie also did 155, which is about where the last Wolverine movie was.
Yeah, 132. I feel like this is just not going to live in that neighborhood. I think it's going to be above 190 for sure.
Okay.
How much? And listen, I'm going to have to eat. Number one, I'm already buying you a steak. So there's no world in which I am not already the butthole. I'm not already the cat's asshole on this one. But how much of this is just the fact that it's the Wolverine movie that could not be more tailored to you? Like
I will freely admit that, but the part of the reason it's so tailored for me is, number one, I'm the target buying demographic. Number two, like, I mean, no lie, I was showing the trailer to my 9-year-old and she was watching it saying like, that girl's like me. And then, you know, and punching her fists up in the air, pretending to beat people up. I mean, there is something about the way they're putting this together, it's going to appeal to it's about a superhero taking care of his dad and his daughter, and that's going to resonate with the world, and also he's badass Hugh Jackman.
Okay. All I'm saying is this, is that you were the target demographic for Wolverine as you were a comic-aged boy.
Yep.
I'm just saying that there is certainly a bias that now that you are an man who has understood his age with a daughter the same age as the main character.
I'm very, like, very
now,
aware.
Now your wish fulfillment is even tighter tailored to this story for you, right?
All of that is possible. However, more importantly, Bad Weave in the chat says, how about this? If Logan doesn't make $170 million in the first 4 weeks, I'll up my Patreon to $75 per show. All of a sudden, number one, we'll take that bet. Number two, I demand everybody boycott this movie. Nobody should watch it, ever.
Wait, 175 in the first week?
No, 4 weeks. 4 weeks.
4 weeks. In the first 4 weeks.
He's basically taking a softer line.
I can see it doing better. I can see it doing better than the Wolverine. I guess it also matters on what opens that same.
I mean, here's the thing. It has insane. It has Guardians of the Galaxy level buzz. Which,
okay. You are getting way over the top with this buzz. Because, like, I follow the same people on Twitter, and, like, I see, you know, Pete Serretta and Jeff Cannata saying, hey, this is a really good movie. Or the most positive thing that I saw about it was somebody say, hey, this is my favorite movie of 2017, which by my watch is a month and 21 days old, where historically nothing but dog shit movies come out.
I guess I'm going by the numbers, because the other thing I have to compare it to is the fact that the recent story came out that Guardians of the Galaxy was the highest tested friends and family screening they'd ever have for number two. I don't know. Time will tell. We already got our bet locked in. I gave you the chance to change, and you said no. You're sticking, and you are unfazed by the overwhelmingly positive reception that has gotten.
How many movies get a gigantic? I can't see. Not that I can't see it, because I can see it overperforming. I just don't think it will. Because at the end of the day, a good Wolverine movie, a good X-Men movie, does wonders, right? Whenever they're good, everybody is really excited about it and flips out. Even when they're, like, better than good, like the X-Men where they're both generations, Days of Future Past.
Yep.
Doctor in the Diamond Club, I think, has got the button on this. What buzz is he talking about? This does not have Deadpool buzz.
I mean, I guess we'll find out. We'll
find out.
I don't really have a response to that. I mean, I am certainly seeing what I feel like to be a sufficient amount of buzz and positive reviews that to stick to my side, but you two disagree, and that's a fine thing. You are welcome to do.
When does it come out?
The 3rd, March 3rd.
Okay.
I can go see it a second time with you when you get into town.
Yeah, I'll be in the Cuse. I'm in Syracuse that weekend. Mm-hmm. Anyway, we should probably wrap up the show. We're not done with the show.
Yeah, this is a podcast going on.
No, sorry. Look, it's been delightful to hang out with you guys. We had a really good time. Found out that Apologizes For remains my favorite game. Best phrase for you to set up in your Google News feed.
Oh, man, that's great. Eureka Geek in the Twitch just says, the buzz must have been coming from that warehouse the way he was working.
Right. Hey, by the way, for the record,
put on the record?
There ain't too many square feet that ain't buzzing, like within a 100-mile radius of right here. There ain't nothing special about that place. Hey, man, we love you guys. We're going to figure out details for South by Southwasted.
Check the Reddit, check the Twitter. We'll have something when we have something.
That's right. DiamondClub.reddit.com. Get in that community, yo.
Night Attack Show.
Tuesday!
Live forever! Siempre viva!
Oh, Justin Robert Young, every time you go, I get so sad that I wanna drink a warm glass of Drano. Night attack,
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 night attack.
I love you.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.